So Wednesday, July 15th, meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. First item on the agenda is general public comment.
Matt, believe it or not, I'm here with.
Oh, we're so excited.
No, it's the Olympics.
It's free. Say something to us, please.
Are you contemplating running for the CPA? Is that what you?
I'm contemplating running.
Let's make this meeting exceptionally short.
And fascinating.
I see candy, so that's good.
All right, the next item is minutes, which we have minutes of 20th. Motion to approve.
I have a couple of corrections. I'll give them to Sarah directly. That's for the 5:20.
Yes.
Yes.
Were those just typos or were those substantive?
Bit turns to but, away turns to aware, and round is not plural.
All right. I'll check it.
I offered one also to Sarah already, so I would move to approve.
He's already moved. Second, so.
One favor. We'll move it quickly.
Yes. So with those corrections, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Standing? Come on, attention.
I wasn't.
Is that second extension? Doesn't matter. You can vote to accept them as the minutes, regardless of whether you're. All right. Okay, the next is the chair's report, which is, this is my last meeting. Thank you all for your cooperation during my reign there.
How long has your reign been?
I don't even know.
You were here when I got here.
I was the accidental president, so.
I've been staff for 5.5 years and you were here before I left.
No. No, I was here. I've been here on the committee since 2000.
You took over from Fran, is that right?
No, 2009. Took over from Kevin.
Right.
Who took over from?
Took over from. So the other item is, have you heard anything, sir, about the funding? I have not received an email.
I haven't, no.
And I guess.
They're probably.
It's still in conference committee, so we've not heard anything on that. So, and I just walked by the park. And I noticed that the mayor had sent out a post on Facebook about the green. And I thought, nice pun, Mr. Mayor. The money is now being used.
Are you getting a lot of negative stuff, sir, for the trees coming down?
DPW said they only have received, I think, one comment about the Christmas tree.
I have to say, walking through it, I like it.
The space, no, that's my comment as I came in, is that the space and with the landscaping, I think, is pretty nice.
Seems much bigger.
Yeah.
It does seem bigger, and also when the sumac trees at that and a couple of those sort of odd pines come down, it will open it up to the south as well, so it'll seem like a different place. So we have these small projects procedures, which this is continuation of last meeting's business, and we have the documents typed up. Now, I know there was a bit of a glitch with the format.
I don't know, so when I added Dave's words to the form, some of them disappeared. I don't know why, but those aren't changes from the last session.
No.
So we're talking about procedures or the form?
Both. We're talking about the form.
The form was missing.
The form is a document. So I believe that.
So we caught that today.
Yes.
Carter was kind enough to go back and fix it up, but we didn't have a chance to get it out because it was advanced, so decided to print it out. Wait for that version.
Oh, yeah.
And the one thing to note, in case you're curious, is that the box in which all of those questions are contained is expandable, so as they type, the box gets bigger, so they're not as space limited as the computer.
So we would prefer that you keep the space provided is...
Well, you never know. If someone has three pages, they might just want to attach it.
I have a question about the first one, and that is, does everybody know where the CPA plan is? I mean, it says, be sure and check the plan. And I went looking on the website, and I just wonder, is it as obvious to them where to find the plan to work from?
So the final version will have a hyperlink. I'm assuming it's going to change.
That's the answer.
But if I'm giving someone a hard copy, that'll help.
Okay. The other thing is, we use CPC and CPA. I think you're all familiar with it. I think if somebody's flying, they probably are too. But USGS, maybe they don't know what that acronym means.
I think a lot of people don't know the difference between what CPA and CPC stands for. I don't see council members.
And then
it has to be used interchangeably without meaning both us and the act and the actions that result from the act.
And in number six, natural resources. I know natural is so important, but it's not capitalized. And zoning somewhere was the same thing. Oh, the same one. Zoning probably should be, but those are just English stuff. I thought it read great. I think we've come a long way.
Okay, other comments on the combined?
So 6A, I guess photographs should be capitalized. I actually think USGS should stay because people call it Topo Maps USGS.
Okay.
And I think those things are good to change CPC and CPA. I think these are all tiny things. I think it's great. The second page, project location, including address and parcel number, colon, not period.
We're just both showing up that we read it on the time.
Exactly.
Sarah, are you catching these since you have the latest version?
Some of them. And I'll go back and read the translation. So USGS for...
Yeah, I'm with Ryan. It's fine.
Page 3, budget summary, these MUST, M-U-S-T. These news.
So I just had a question on that because as to language, what do we as a committee, I know that we discussed sort of up to this issue, but I don't think we really ended it. What does it mean must be secured? What evidence, just for staff's guidance, what evidence of having secured that funding is required, or should they expect to provide to the committee? So that if they say, I got an email that says, we're good to go with that 2,000, are they going to come in to a future committee and more formal letter, so just because assuming that most of these conversations will be happening with staff, because we're going to get the applications, we're not going to be expecting to act on them, possibly without the applicant present. I'm just thinking.
Am I right in thinking there'll be all kinds that it would be hard to say exactly what we do? I would take an email from somebody who you knew in town, he said, yes, I'm going to agreement with offering up my corner of this lot to do ABC?
Well, so I'm not so concerned about the in-kind as I am. The in-kind does not apply to the cap of the $6,000. I mean, I'm talking about the cash money. Again, because we're potentially committing, you know, significant amounts of money. And if one applicant said, I have an email that says, if you get the CPA money, I'll have mine. Okay, that's maybe $3,000 if the person doesn't come through. But if that becomes the standard and you have five or six of them, then you might have $15,000 of CPA money that you've committed. And if a number of those don't come through, since we've put a pretty high percentage, right? If you have a $6,000 project and you don't get half the money, it's probably not happening. I'm just wondering if everyone else coming.
I was thinking it would be a commitment letter. I don't know, 2 or 3 even though they have money in hand.
Right.
But I think something more than an email.
To me, a signature matters. You know, a commitment letter has a signature on it, and somebody has signed something. I feel like that's...
Other? I mean, I'm just thinking that you would also want the commitment to somehow pertain to the application, because if I speak to you in advance and I say, I'm going to put up these signs, the signage, and you say, okay, that sounds good, but then the application comes in and the signs, I think the signs are ugly, and I say, I really don't want to give you my $1,000 for those ugly signs. So I'm wondering how, you know, they're not the person providing the funding is not a co-applicant, but usually when we have people providing matching funds, they're aware of what that project is going to produce, whether it's a housing project or whether it's open space or recreation. Here again, I'm just trying to, I'm not trying to make excessive formality, but at least give the community a sense that the person who's providing the cash is aware of what
people do. Based on that, would you be open to adding to the end of that last sentence, including any restrictions or requirements attached to such funding? So that if another agency is funding the applicant for up to $3,000, we can see what, can respond to what Downey just said, and making sure that they're funding the same thing that we're funding, and then we see any restrictions or requirements that they're putting on their funding.
How about this? These funds must be secured at the time of application as evidenced by a signed commitment letter referencing the content of the application and including any restrictions on the use of funds.
Yes.
Yeah, and again, and I'm really thinking about more guidance for staff. Again, if people come in and they say, I don't quite have that, then staff can say, well, you know, you can go ahead with it, but the application does constantly get assigned signed by
the Dave, what was the end of that? As evidenced by commitment letter, that?
By a signed commitment letter, referencing the content of the application, comma, and including any restrictions on the use of funds or use of matching funds.
And then delete include commitment letter available.
And it sounds like I'm in the minority on this, but since this is the first time that the small grants and think there's a concern, there's been concerns expressed that there's not going to be sufficient interest. I would almost put off the formalities until we see whether it becomes necessary.
Well, that would be, I mean...
And I would just say satisfactory evidence of commitment of the funds. And that Sarah, if she feels comfortable with that, or if she, you know, does, if you feel like you want this kind of hard line, then that's fine. But if you feel like you could advise of an applicant,
it really depends on the committee, and what you prefer to see. If you say, well, an email is fine, then an email is fine, that's okay. But if you would prefer to see something a little more concrete and so forth, that's kind of cool.
Right. I mean, that's my, the reason I'm really asking you a question to the committee, because you all are going to be voting on these. And if two people are comfortable with an email, but the rest of you are not, and that means, and we're telling Sarah right now that people come in and say, I got this email from this organization that's willing to do it, but then they get rejected and they say, why did we get rejected? And they say, oh, well, two people on the committee were okay with an email, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 were not. And so I'm just trying to get a sense of,
okay,
you know, for whoever's going to be voting in this round, whether you, like, what guidance do you give to Sarah? Again, you're, at least on this specific point. And again, you might be persuaded by a great project that had a lower, maybe lower evidence of a commitment, but just again.
Are you saying, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Are you saying that you're concerned that let me start by saying, I'm okay with email, I think if it's coming from sort of a, you can identify where it's coming from, you know,
right,
it's not some cryptic email address. It's still with this sort of this language of what has to be in the body of it, I do feel like we're in an electronic age and that's okay. I also think it's not unreasonable to expect somebody to give you a letter, but were you saying when you first brought this up about setting a precedent just for the small grants or?
Oh, no, this is just for, I'm just saying, I wasn't necessarily looking to change the language of the application. I was just looking to see when they say, when I'm the applicant who says, well, it says include commitment letters available. I guess I could get a commitment letter, but I already have this email. Do you think that, they say this to Sarah, do you think that's enough? They say that in August. So I'm trying to get a sense of what does this committee want Sarah to say at that point? What will your, all of your threshold, it sounds like if you're comfortable without the additional language, then we don't need the additional language. But if it's going to trip up
I like the additional language, I just don't need it to be a printed hard copy letter. I'm okay with it being an email with that content.
My only reason for preferring a signed letter is just with small amounts. If someone approaches a PTO and says, hey, will you give us $50? And someone says, yeah, you can email that they're not speaking for the entire organization. At least that way you have a good value to your process and getting an official signature. That makes me feel more comfortable. I can see, I think that the flip side of, $3,000 is what they get a $10 donation from the ground. It's like they really need to commit to but I think the content is probably the most important part.
Well, is my suggestion of sign making it too formal? Because that's the piece that makes it a letter more likely than it is in the mail or electronic communication.
I like this.
If somebody's going to email you and then you say, well, actually it has to have all this, they might just write you a letter anyway, because then it's become that effort of referencing the project and kind of a letter.
I think make sure it's on.
You might as well look into some letters.
Right, so it sounds at least the consensus is that they should never have a signed letter information that they have. All right, moving right along, we have the criteria and the need served.
So this is the procedure discussion?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're still, I think we're still moving through this document. Is there any other additional corrections on that?
For number two, at the end of the first sentence, this just becomes awkward. Perhaps please refer to the overview, page 6, and applicable program criteria. Get rid of the underscore, whatever that weird thing there is. But start with something.
Mm-hmm.
And something before overview. Maybe just please refer to the overview.
Yeah.
Over
review of what?
Well, that's the section title in the plan.
Yeah. And I think it's...
Would somebody understand what?
You could say, please review to the overview section of the plan on page 6.
Yeah.
Applicable program criteria, historic preservation, replace it after on page 14, community housing on page 22, open space on page 24.
Basic species, removal
yeah.
stuff.
Yeah.
If it's coming in, that could be getting a bunch more of that.
Historic walking tour comes to mind.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Archiving historic documents, all the legal lessons and books.
All right, the next item on the agenda is the review schedule for round 2 2015. Copies of this point, again, other than our small grants people, I think the most applicants expect in mid-August.
I've gotten a few questions from possible applicants, so I haven't sent out a question.
Sarah, yeah. Excuse me. Do you have any idea how much money we'll have?
$1.4 million total, but I don't know what I'm going to do.
$1.4 million total for fall and spring. And would we be allowed to use some of that to go to Pulaski? I mean, will it have all gone out to be bonded by then?
It would have to go back to city council if we made any change in how the cash is being appropriated.
But would it be too late to do that by?
It would have to go back to city council, so they need to move it out.
So
I
think
that
would be over.
Well, I'm just one. No, I'm thinking of even just bringing down the borrowing amount. If we don't have any projects coming in the fall, we can still fund more in Pulaski. Are we allowed to do that if the project hasn't?
The committee couldn't do the letter we do it, so we'd have to go to city council with a revised council order. It's possible. I'm not sure if people are open the door.
Well, maybe the question is if it hasn't been bonded by that time, can the council?
It is possible.
But you're advising against it?
No, it would depend on whether the committee wanted to take it back to council for another discussion.
That'd be all over. Yeah.
Pulaski Park will be coming back. Okay.
Do you have a sense when they are going to be bonding, or is that still unknown?
It's still unknown. It depends on what other projects the city is doing at the bond.
The one thing to sort of keep in mind that they will be coming back, though, is that then they're going to be in a construction phase at the very end of the year at best, or over the winter, at a time when that just doesn't seem like the right time to be doing that. So maybe we could get a little caught up in one funding round while we just say we'll get to that next year when it's the next construction season.
For the money that's already been allocated, or for the money that's going to be open?
It's going out to bid, or has it gone out to bid?
It has gone out to bid.
And so what is the timetable again?
DPW should be contracting, if they haven't already, within the month.
Yeah,
the papers said August 1st.
Bids are open and they're selected.
All the work that's been done so far has been done.
I'm sorry?
All the work that's been done so far, so the tree removal and the playground, other stuff has been done by the DPW.
Sarah, do you think that, just looking at that December city council votes, if there's a snow event, given that the council is expiring?
They're expiring?
Well, they're
changing.
Rolling out?
Yes. So it'll be a new council, so these years, if you don't get our work done, and create a situation where the one council considers it, and then they have to start.
Right. Well, the first Wednesday is the 2nd of December, so it's as early as we know.
Yeah, and the only other way to change it would be to make another extra meeting. I just sort of already one in here, potentially, or to erase the opportunity for some of the discussion.
I think November 11th is Veterans Day. Is it your advice?
Veterans Day can be on a Wednesday? I thought it was. Veterans Day is always a Monday.
No,
it was on
Monday.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, it is.
11th hour of the 11th day.
So, anyway, that's up to you all as far as.
I'll agree to anything 3 months off.
All right, so is there a motion to accept the schedule?
So are we just deleting November 11th? Because that's making I threw into the 18th in as an extra meeting.
I thought we weren't to read the vote.
Well, we can't meet them.
It was my, well, it was my understanding from the past that the committee's pleasure was not to do recommendations and council orders and conditions in the same meeting. But that was the expressed preference. Given that, again, recommendations and time allows usually allows for some discussion, but if you got rid of the 11th, you would have one meeting on the 18th under the gun to get everything done, all conditions written.
Mm-hmm. Can I offer a suggestion then?
Yes.
Can we scrap November 11th and have back-to-back meetings with the applicant on the October 7th and October 14th? And then we could have...
Then move public comment up to the 21st?
21st, and then we could have November 4th for ourselves. Then we would have to consider what we've heard.
Right. How's everyone feel about that?
That sounds fine.
That's more meetings in October.
Yeah, I don't think we can do it in one meeting. I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
And one of those meetings that this may have not been moved. It just depends on how many hours
we have. Yeah, I guess the thing is, so I'd rather have it on the calendar and we get closer to it and everybody says, we really don't need that, as opposed to trying to do it the other way around.
So what is it, October 7th, 14th, and 21st? And then now November 11th?
No.
November 4th, we're discussing.
So the 4th and the 18th. Okay, that changed. Is that acceptable?
And this is the most meetings we would ever have, if anything, this would be reduced.
And so we're not meeting again until the 16th.
August.
I had one down in August, no?
We had one in August as a placeholder just in case something came in. An expedited app or if we decided to have
a review. That does not look like that's happening.
We haven't gotten to the discussion yet of the plan. And we haven't done my part on it, so it might be an August meeting.
All right, so if that is acceptable to everyone, Sarah, you can go ahead.
And I will send it out.
Notice. The next is the plan update discussion. So since Glenn is stepping down, that would change the responsibilities there as far as updating. I don't know how far people have gotten in updating or changing. Again, I would remind everyone that we don't need to change it for change's sake. If you read through it and you feel like your section fairly represents to people reading it what the needs are and what the procedures are, then I don't think at this point we need to amend it.
So at about 4 o'clock this afternoon, I thought, wonder what section I've got. And so I went looking, and I couldn't get, when I open the minutes on the website, I get the agenda, but I can't get to the minutes underneath them. So there's some trick that this old Luddite...
It's a different button. So it's the moment still, right?
No, I'll, you can show me later. I'm embarrassed enough to admit it.
But the meeting you were looking at may not have had minutes. The only ones that are up there are approved. Even if I do draft ones, I can't put them up there because then they disappear and lose white
hole. Okay. So I think I had open space, which made sense because that would be what you think planning board would.
No,
I think I assigned you to the procedural overall.
Oh.
I wasn't quite sure who had what, so I just wrote that things were assigned.
Well, do you want my comments on open space?
I do not have my list in front of me, but I'm remembering that I had Devin with the overview. Obviously, David is still with Historic.
So that I would read the 61 pages, right?
Yeah.
We only assign things to, to each as to their abilities.
And it cannot be read online. Let me just tell you that. And I didn't want to print out 61 pages. So I... a little hamstrung, but I did think I had open space, and I'll give you my comment on that. take care of it. And so we're looking at the 2012 through 14.
Yes.
To turn it into the 2015 to 17. Okay. So my only comment is just we've got some really old stats and numbers in there. So for open space, you know, it's at the number of acres and the percentage of land, and those are all have been outdated by now.
Yeah.
But other than that, the rest of it for details read fine. And I don't know who could do that other than you and Wayne. But that was my only comment about open space.
I did read the housing, and I thought the need was discussion was unfortunately we haven't met all those needs.
Mm-hmm.
That was still accurate, but it was the same that the projects today, the funds expended today, plus the fact that we've now spent money for housing support, which I hadn't done before, so some of the discussion.
And I don't know if it belongs in there, but when we were looking, when we were discussing the project for the housing coordinator,
mm-hmm.
I was astounded that that we knew as much about people's housing as we do. It just caught me off guard. I've not read the housing piece of the plan, but how many people are homeless and how long they're homeless. And there were just a lot of facts in that. I remember from that proposal more than I do the building construction pieces we've been through more recently. But I remember just thinking, wow, they really do know a lot about it. And I don't know if some of that could go into the plan of just convincing that it's not a baby problem, it's a quantifiable problem.
Yeah, I have to think about that. Because the housing partnership has done us the whole assessment, so it's looked at from a lot of different angles, and there's a lot of stuff you put in there, and what you could, which of that you could address with CPA funds.
Yeah. Okay.
Because otherwise, you're just doing a laundry list.
Yeah. So no,
you're reciting what's in already.
I do think it's long already. So.
I guess I'm not clear what the process is for actually making the changes. Do you want to discuss to somehow try to get a Word document, redline stuff, or just give concepts to changes and? How much of a role do you expect in the program?
It's been different every year. I'm happy to go through with Wayne and with Andrew Mosier and whoever else and update things that are outdated. That's pretty simple. I'm comfortable doing that. But I don't want to make value judgments about
right.
Where I'm going to end up.
So
the committee's done it, just kind of sitting here and going through the whole thing. Of course, that can be a little tedious. But it depends on how comfortable everybody is with the plan.
What if you
want ideas?
Sure, I mean, I'll just tell you, there was, in previous iterations, people gave their information to the chair, and the chair, we really liked drafting the plan. We drafted the plan pretty extensively. And the last iteration we did, it was pretty much each person who wanted to make changes just drafted their changes in a red line copy and handed it over. Some discussions, but not a tremendous amount of discussion about those changes to the plan. Again, if they aren't major in information, I would guess staff would be able to update statistics and information on things that we have done.
Yeah, to me the biggest thing, the biggest challenge for us moving forward is squaring those needs with, you know, you can update the information, but looking strategically at the needs and whether or not the commitments we've made thus far has helped reach those goals and acknowledge that might be true. So in the open space, the target may be changed, but that gives the appearance that we'll never reach a target, whereas it would be nice to have consideration with the assistance of CPC up to this point, you know, we met this much of this target, but, you know, here's what, you know, either a master plan or something suggests that, you know, it's revised, and here's the rationale for having more. And the same with affordable housing. I think, unfortunately, those needs will rarely ever be satisfied. but it seems if some of these projects that we committed funding to were successful, you know, we have 40 units there and 60 units there and 50 units somewhere else, we can't do the same ask. I think what's hard for us is some communities actually write down the top five priorities. We had money, this is what we spent on. We traditionally haven't done that. We just said, here's what all of our other plans say. So, you know, do we want to go that direction? Do we satisfy some core needs? Do we want to prioritize others? And I don't know if people feel comfortable with that. I haven't up until now, but I feel like we're also bumping up against that point. We express that in various meetings, you know, when people come in and say, well, has this changed? What are we doing? What's the next thing you want to focus on? And if we have a desire to focus, this would be our opportunity to do it.
And none of the major plans that we referenced in our plan have been updated since we first put this together. So we don't have any updated information that we can get closer.
But it seems that's an opportunity for us before we make the revision to go back to those entities to assemble them and say, we really need you to contribute something here instead of accepting the status quo.
The only challenge with that is that the plans that are out there have been accepted by city council and they had a lot of public input, and if we're just asking if department heads and committees, how would you revise this? I wouldn't have that same level of input.
Well, we could at least ask when the next update would be, or encourage them to do it in their experience.
You know, Wayne has talked about starting the process for the sustainability plan.
Not September, sir.
So I don't know what other ones are in the works.
Sarah, can you pull up the plan?
Sure.
So the housing needs assessment study that's referenced, that was a huge undertaking, but I know that part of what the partnership does is reports on the status of any of those goals or efforts they're making. So I don't know if you had asked them for input or not, because it is something that is formally kind of done. Where are we with things that are relevant?
Not since the previous plan.
Did they post that on there?
I don't know, but I think I mean, I definitely have some comments, but I don't think they're huge. And maybe I don't know how we're going forward because we heard some various ways, but maybe I could. I don't know who to send it to because I don't know how it turns, but I guess send it to Sarah and CCU. So at least, you know, if we're covering the same territory, I don't know if we're going to try to draft language or not, but just since we're both looking at it, so.
Talk. Well, obviously, the chair current is not going to assemble our plans, and I think it would be an onerous assignment to put on whoever steps in. So I like the idea of asking Sarah to go through it with planning office contacts and any other, that doesn't preclude us sending something in, but then I would really prefer a PDF or a Word doc after some faffing around has been done to it, and then I'll do what I should have already done. Does that sound like a plain Word doc?
Yeah. It won't be pretty. This wasn't done in Word, so the Word document is not going to be attractive. But it will be workable.
Well, if it were a PDF, you can always just drop in sticky notes and not try to edit it.
No, I'm happy to send it in Word. Okay. The formatting will be the same. Okay.
So just, I do think, however, that I think that if you have a particular, like it seems like you're addressing specific issues that you've had with where the plan is services the work that the committee's done. And I would think that if you're not expecting the chair to sort of collect all of your comments and produce a draft, then I do think that it would make sense to assign the drafting to individuals on this committee. Recognizing that you will have to turn out a draft for the approval of the rest of the committee. But again, with the proviso that once we have those names and we all write them down tonight, that if you have, you know, if you have a specific issue that you're looking, let's say I'm open space, I'm looking through housing, and I say, wait, this says absolutely nothing about providing services, neither in needs or in sort of highlighting that it's already been done, which was new, you know, sort of an innovative program, so that someone else who is, you know, providing services to individuals would also say, oh, I can do this in Northampton. But I would be, my responsibility would be to communicate that to the key drafter. And we can have one person be key drafter or two people, but again, I think that at the end of the day, it will come down to somebody taking responsibility for each section. And that's the way it worked last time, or you can just give it to Julia Shavon when she arrives.
I think that's fine, but I would prefer to have sort of the factual update first, okay, as a starting point. I don't know how long you think that would take to do. And that goes.
Okay. Can I put down names? Yes, now that I'm actually not going to allow my last act. So I'm putting Brian down for open space.
Yeah.
I'd like to be on open space too.
Okay. But Brian is the, he's the, would you like to be the principal drafter? You want to
play? I'll help Brian. Okay.
Sarah, while he's talking, can you go to page 27?
Oh, so you can read as I go
through. No, I just, yes.
Come back to the story.
I think I wrote it last time.
So David is being the point person on historic preservation. Housing.
Tony and I have been.
Who's the lead? Who's the lead author?
Well, just a little.
Well, I'm happy to be late. Well, just, I just think so that, should review
thank you, this. Well, just so that, no, absolutely. I'm just saying, because I just want to have a person who, somebody else with a comment on housing is not going to play the game of trying to get to both of you and then having passed on. So that's what I'm saying. So Tony, I'll put you as the housing lead person. Again, you,
yep,
however you divide the work is going to be good to you. Do we want to have a separate person for recreation?
Glenn and I are going to do it. Glenn is going to lead for
Glenn. Glenn is not.
When do we expect Glenn?
It's going to city council for their next meeting, whatever the next meeting is. I don't know if they refer it out. I don't think so.
Is there a person that's been chosen?
Yeah, it's Julia Shavon. So, she's been chosen, but they're on a monthly schedule, aren't they, during the summer? So they've had the July meeting.
And they may refer it out to the committee. I'm not sure. If it's coming from another board, they might know.
Okay. So, yeah. All right, and
Alice is Evelyn, but overall, okay, you want to do that? So you can share that after and all.
So to reiterate what Dave said, when I was reviewing open space, under the needs thing, I think that the needs section exists in each of the four categories. I mean, I don't see our job as determining what the needs are, but in attempting to fulfill the needs that have been met. So this is what I still don't understand. If in fact the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board have not updated this, then we cannot revise this. Is that correct?
And that's part of the reason for having the public hearing about the needs related to community preservation. But people just generally, unfortunately, aren't interested in a general type discussion. They like more project focused type stuff.
Because it seems to me this is the most, our goal is to attempt to review project based on what the community needs are.
So this is from the open space plan.
So we just accept what this is without tweaking this, given our own personal preference.
Well, even more than that, it seems presumptuous to tweak it.
Yeah. Well, I don't.
don't necessarily agree. If we've expended millions of dollars in tennis fields, it seems like we could acknowledge, recognizing the contribution of the following projects, right? You can tweak it to acknowledge that some of those goals may have been met by our prior allocations.
You go to page 28 of the documentation.
Some of our, for the 4 years, either if we have to or not, we've been trying to accomplish these goals. So if you suggest that they're static, it doesn't feel right here. There's got to be some way to run.
Let's go up to speed.
So like this is an example of something that I would update. Okay, so I would say since 2007, the city has protected approximately whatever it is. So I'll update that stuff.
Yeah, and that's some kind of things I'll
have ready. Can you do the historical preparation?
Yeah, I'll do the whole thing. I'll go through it all.
Okay, and then what you're talking about is very philosophical. It's like you're saying, okay, let's take our project accomplishments list and divvy it up into the areas that they belong in, and say how they have influenced the needs that were previously in different plans. Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, if we have something that says we need X many SRO units, and we have satisfied that with our commitments, it doesn't seem like another project coming in saying your SRO would necessarily satisfy that need because it's already been fulfilled. And so it would be nice if we can update the plan upon which this is premised. We can. But it seems like for us, we can at least say, this one seems to have been met.
Is there a duality approach that we recognize that these plans aren't all current? They can't be.
Yeah.
That we just say these were the plan needs that we've been addressing, and then maybe somewhere else talk about, and we've not changed the needs, because I don't know that I have that insight, but just sort of a great card of what areas we have been working in, so that when they revise the plans, they look at it.
Yeah, Matt. There are some, I'm elected, so I don't have a committee to report to you. But this is an opportunity when you draft your section to go back to your committees and say, we need this plan, your plan, our committee plan to be updated, because we are having trouble trying to figure out what the needs are. We feel like we've met some of these, and we don't have any guidance on what the new needs may be, or how things have changed, or how to prioritize things, and encourage folks to redo those plans. Those efforts. They don't hear from us, no. So, I mean, one, most people think those, no one ever reads those plans, and they're useless. The reality is, they can be really useful. They're referenced all the time in our applications, but they're outdated. So, it's an incentive, push it in the right direction, and we plan at least acknowledge what we need as a city and a committee to get to those ends. I think there's some more to fill in. But I think we should take stock of where we're coming.
And Sarah, no one has done that, right? Look at all of, historically, to go back and look at all of our allocations and see, sort of specifically, see which needs they have attended to.
We have not.
I mean, that's an impossible thing to ask you given your time constraints.
It would be, some of them are all of the needs, and some of them might be one very particular need, and we might disagree about what those needs are.
I mean, you get an intern in who could, it really would be interesting and to have someone devote a lot of time to seeing, really what have we done, but that seems like a huge.
So just take every project and list which criteria we think that's
important. I don't know.
Yeah. Not everyone might agree on the result.
Maybe it's an interesting question. I know we're certainly keeping track of the categories of the grants, but in the only what 6 years, a long time that I've been here, I've never seen us really spend a lot of time on that issue, because usually the issues are more related to the level of public support or the amount of funding stability or some of the more practical issues that surround an application. So I think it's fine to go into this, and it's an interesting topic, but I've never seen this committee use that or the absence of information on that as a key determiner in whether we fund the project or not, as long as it's meeting the some of the core identified goals.
I may be wrong, but some of the areas I don't think are as quantifiable as others. And what I'm hearing from you is that your concerns, particularly around open space, where I think there's some very concrete goals established and you can measure those types of those goals. The recreation facility is also a little bit more measurable and quantifiable. Affordable housing, there isn't really so many SRO units that you're ever going to get close to or affordable family. You know, the need is so large that you're not going to get there. So I guess I would not try to do this, you know, somewhat universally. And maybe the emphasis should be on updating the open space, pushing for updating the open space and for recreation. But in general, I think we're always going to be chasing these plans because they are so intensive. And I think that we're going to be able to update this plan every 2 years or 3 years based on updated plans, to me, is not realistic. So I guess I wonder if we really need to do it every 2 or 3 years, or would it make more sense to be like on a, you know, just to go through something where you're not really doing anything useful. It doesn't seem to me to be a good expenditure of time. It would be better to have a longer review schedule that would allow for some real push on the plans that really could be very goal oriented, could be something to measure and use. It could then really impact the
plan. What do we say for updating our plan every how many years?
We have it on a 2-year schedule. There's no requirement for it.
Just to, you know, what the statute says is that CPC shall study the needs and possibilities and resources of the city or town regarding community preservation, including consideration of regional projects for community preservation. The committee shall consult, which means we have to, right? We shall consult with existing municipal boards, including the Conservation Commission, the Historical Commission, Planning Board, the Board of Park Commissioners, and the Housing Authority, or persons acting in those capacities or performing like duties in conducting such studies. As part of its study, the committee shall hold one or more public informational hearings on the needs, possibilities, and resources of the city, town regarding community preservation possibilities and resources. There's no mention of plan. The word plan is not used in the statute. This committee decided to have a plan as many CPCs have. The 2-year cycle is, again, artificial. I can see what Dave is saying in terms of, that you wouldn't want to have people read the plan and think that there was a need that their project was satisfying and then come to this committee and be disappointed. But I think the rebuttal to that is the sense that David had, which we really haven't had a project. I mean, whenever I get a project, when the projects come in, I go usually to the last financial report, which has all the projects listed by dollar amount, and I could, you know, say, okay, I remember that project. I think if we got more ball fields, that we would ask and say, wait a second, we spent $2 million on Florence Fields. Maybe that's a need that we've done well in. And if we had, let's say, a smaller downtown park, we might say, well, we haven't really done so well with downtown parks. So I guess my sense would be, are we misleading people with the current plan's needs? And if we have a committee, I think we, you know, it says we'll study them. It really doesn't say what we publish as far as our plan.
Or time.
So the study and the plan are not necessarily the same thing, right? And it doesn't say how many times you're supposed to study it either. So again, that's up to this committee as to.
Well, and as a footnote to Linda's comment, I see open space and recreation as being somewhat quantifiable, and I see housing and historic as not. When we get enough historic projects preserved, I don't know that.
True. I mean, I agree with you, but each of the last funding rounds that we've had affordable housing, I would come in and say, this is the highest priority. We need to take care of elderly and we have to have senior staff identified and happy when they say it's that SROs is the number one priority, and once you meet this, you can move on to other things. And so if our applicants are making those representations, it has to be based on something. And I just want to know, I mean, someone sitting on the committee, I think the boundary is identified, right, which is around the applicants. We should be studying the needs and not necessarily studying what someone said the needs were a few years ago.
Yes, Dave, but even that example, I'm not going to know more about housing than they do as the applicant coming in. If they think they can put together the funding for a housing project, they know much more about it than I do.
Well, that's true, but their interest is in their housing project. Our interest is what the community need is for housing. So.
My caution, I hear you, and I like the idea of that's implicit in what you're saying about being planful and thoughtful and responsive to our broad constituency. The other side of that is the potential of us becoming a top-down body that, Brian spoke to this 10 minutes ago about us directing where the grant should go almost separately from all of the applications or the type of applications that come in. And I still think that there's a lot to be said for us sitting in adjudication of the grants, the quality of the grants, and if we're not out of process, we wouldn't be needed, and we certainly wouldn't be needed for the hours that we serve. I think it's a deliberative process that reflects the discussion and the back and forth between different constituencies of this body. And I'm probably more comfortable with that than establishing a top-down menu.
No, and I agree, and that's what I promised in my discussion group, is that's okay. The risk.
Okay.
Continue on that pendulum. But I feel like, again, if there are places where the needs that have been identified may be satisfied or are part of there, we should be involved. That's really what I'm looking for. Like, if you don't have a plan saying where our needs are, let's at least acknowledge how far we've gotten.
But not satisfied by what Sarah
is doing? I usually just plug in, so I'm raising my hand. So I just, at some point, I'd like to add something. So I know that the statute defines a percentage for each category, correct?
Minimum percentage.
Yeah, minimum percentage. But it made me nervous to hear, well, we can quantify open space, because as far as I'm concerned, that's the most important thing. To me, the CPA Act, that's why I voted for it. So I would never want to see a cap on it. I don't think it is quantifiable, because all of this is driven by what applications we receive. So, and especially with open space, that can't even be predicted, because that depends on what properties come up for sale. So I don't think it is quantifiable what we need, because there are so many people in the community. I know when I went for my shoes and, well, I do concern about open space. There's a lot of people who would be upset if all of a sudden the CPA committee was like, well, that's not a priority. The priority is housing. Well, there's a lot of people who would be upset if you let go. Now I think it's conservation of land and open space. So I think that we're controlled by who applies, and that for us to, I don't think we have the right to prioritize it under the statute to say housing's a priority. So that's what I'm kind of seeing happen. I don't know if I'm being paranoid, but my fear is that we're going to say, okay, we have enough open space, and I know that there have been people who have said that, who have actually said, let's sell it. Gene Chasey, as the city council, let's sell some of this land, you know. So I wouldn't want it to be any category to be a priority. Everything is this community support for every single portion of the act, so I wouldn't want to see that happen.
And I agree with you, and I think there's a difference between the needs and prioritization. Right now, we just list the needs. The question is, have some of them been satisfied, or have they changed since those plans were written? And so for open space, one of our problems is the actual plan that we're depending on actually sets a target, the goal that we've almost satisfied. And so, you know, there are people in this town who say, why are you spending any more money on open space when the plan you're relying on says you shouldn't? And then, you know, you have a broad book that comes in that says the focus should be this Sterile Lake because that's where the need is or the priority is. And so depending on the application that comes in, I would like to get away from that. But we also can't have the folks set an arbitrary number and say, okay, well, we just moved from 25% to 27% for the sake of buying more land. The people who make the plan have to provide a rationale for what it is depending on the needs, and that's what's missing now. And I don't know that we solve that overnight, but that has to be a discussion that we have with the people who run the open space shop.
Well, you know, just one more comment about that. I think that what we don't have is enough nonprofit groups who are addressing the needs of other areas like the Sawmills area. We don't have a group that's coming forward and is as strong as Broadville. I would like to see them, if there be some encouragement to form more nonprofit groups, because we don't have enough voice, we don't have enough applicants for any different open space. The only one I would say is Wayne Feigman. He's done a great job, but but that's a good point, that I didn't realize that he had set a goal. That surprises me. So that's what has to be, I would say, updated.
And Wayne could give you a new goal. He would say, I think it should be this, and it always would have been hired, but it hasn't been vetted in a public plan.
If you could tell me what you're suggesting, because I've lost my way here.
What I'm suggesting is that people who are, like, I'm on recreation. I plan to go to the recreation department and the recreation committee and say, we're undertaking this exercise. We recognize your plan is outdated and hasn't been revised. You know best what your current needs are, what the changes have been since then, and where your priorities are. Can you please tell us what has changed so that we can incorporate it into this plan?
What's your internal timetable for all of this? Because I thought we were feeling some pressure to get this done, which is why I raised the time. But their response, not for you to ask, but for you to receive. I can't imagine the housing partnership moving so quickly unless they've already done it.
So
maybe we need to think about the timing of this if we're going to really be looking at it.
So I thought earlier that Sarah said something like, you know, we can go back to those committees and ask them things, but what authority do they have really to guide us at all if there hasn't been this public vetting? And so I'm not sure if that's really an issue or
That's what they may say to you. So they may provide an additional response, but I don't think any of these committees are going to replace what they have in existing long-term documents.
I think this area that's up right now since 2007 or whatever it will say, is really valuable for trying to document the work that's been done. You know, definitely when I read the housing part, a lot of money's gone to housing in the last year or so. And so, you know, that's obviously not in the current plan and could name that. I don't know, you said some of this is cut and paste from other plans. I really like that all those plans are referenced here. I think that if somebody was taking the time to look at this, it's good for them to know we're not just making this stuff up, or the statute is really based on the process of the rest of the city government and how these committees work. And I agree, it's you know, it's funny to be the representative from the housing authority, because I don't feel like the housing authority is really the authority to be speaking on this. I really feel like it's a housing partnership. I just think they have a broader role, and they don't have a representative here, you know, so I certainly want to seek their input, but it is, I can't even imagine what the housing authority, right? They also have like a business person, you know, like they have their own makeup of their board, so it's a funny thing. So to like think about who should give the input, and I do know that the housing partnership has to, you know, report out. So they probably have some data that maybe we can incorporate, and it's not even about like what we've done, but they've added to it, like what you're saying, like get the feedback. This is in 2015. This has been identified by this committee as priorities, which maybe they won't go on the record with. Maybe, you know, I don't know what we do with the first thing.
Yeah, and I don't know if you need to be limited to one source either. So I mean, I know that one of the open space in the past, we've passed a number of different groups, right? And we also have some of our job work here, as well as the planning commission. So we can at least people wanted to do with the land as opposed to just conserving.
Okay, you're only going to get personal opinions if you don't have enough time to go through a public process. And each of these plans we're talking about have been through committee work and public process. And it's naive to think they're going to get updated every 2 years. I mean, that's just, they are.
Well, they're certainly not going to get updated if we don't ask them to update.
Look, most of them are on schedule. So the open space plan is 2011 to 2018. Sustainable Northampton gets updated once a decade. And that will begin.
What I think better than, since the need statements or policy statements drawn from those kind of documents, what I want to fix is when I read the open space one, I just wanted to get the numbers correct. You know, not 2007, give me 2014. And I think that would go a long way in giving credit, and people could begin to think, and the housing numbers will look really different as far as what projects have been done. But I don't know how those projects change the policy needs, and I don't know who one person could tell me that, really.
So, I mean, just, I know, I think we've gone back and forth with the specific point you've been making about open space virtually for every open space purchase, and because that open space plan is not a conservation commission plan. It's not a conservation plan. It's an open space plan. It's multi-use trails. It's recreation. You get to count anything that doesn't have a building on it as open space practically, which means that all the farmland and the meadows, which is as environmentally disrupted as it could possibly be, is counted as open space. It counts the same as the Marble Brook, right, conservation restriction, which counts the same as Fitzgerald Lake. To pick that one number and say we've met it, I voted for the open space plan because it was a comprehensive plan. Obviously, there are a lot of stakeholders coming together. So to hold it up and say, well, I think conservation should just say no, partly because you have to have an open space plan in place to apply for land grants, to apply for money from the state and federal government. So I think that's why it's not just the thoughts of our conservation commission. Really wide process that comes together, and because it's so labor intensive, the state only requires you to do it every so many years. I would think that it would be fine to call out what has been done to address it, but, and again, every commission member will vote, right, will vote as they choose to vote, and we as a committee have had a sort of priority of saying, well, we want to have sort of equal funding for all these areas. The committee doesn't have to do that. And you could have a committee that just said, we're going to do 10%, 10%, and 80% for open space and recreation. So I guess I would think that since we are in this interim phase, that rather than try to create a process that doesn't exist by forcing these constituent groups to come up with something definitive, what we suggested in the past and we've seen going to do here is you can have part of the public, that public meeting is have those, if those groups are not satisfied with the work that the committee's done, that's their chance to come in and say you're missing the vote. And you know, again, Conservation Commission, the other thing is that just we had a conversation with the Conservation Commission about acquiring small parcels of land, and I was the Conservation Commission member saying, why are we doing this? Why are we taking them off the tax rolls? Why are we taking them off of the stormwater rules? So I don't know whether this happens to other, you know, whether it happens to planning, whether it happens to historic or housing, but my sense is that the representatives at this table bring to us that information without necessarily having it be written up in the plan. And so we are getting, again, I would flag the needs, but I don't know whether we can fully rewrite them on the 2 year cycle.
Assessment at that time, and make sure that we update what has been actually done since then, so it's clear.
Right, yeah.
What work is.
But again, I think that.
And say that that's really what we do.
Yeah, I mean, I think that tasking each person, what I'm trying to do as chair, with tasking you with going to your, either to your board or to your group that is interested in moving that preservation work forward, is that they would come back and say these needs are wrong, right? This information is inaccurate. You might, but again, you might go the other direction. Again, Conservation Commission might come back and say, yeah, that 25% is badly written because it says permanently protected, which means an APR equals a pristine weapon, and that's not the way it should be written. So, but definitely I think that's what we're trying to do. I don't know if it's succeeding or not. Do you have a proposal as to what we would be doing differently in order to change the needs sections?
I have no proposal. I'm just encouraging people to do what I want.
Okay. So.
And I think we're back to what Linda just said, Sarah, if you can, when referring to the needs, make explicit the needs based on what document and when that was published.
For now, I'll at least make notes about that.
Yeah.
And may be able to discern them from some of them.
No. Okay. It would be useful for folks reading the plan to know that these needs were determined by the 2012, was it, when was the last open space?
2011 to 2018,
that they will be given. That that's the best that we can do. Same thing with housing, same thing with, I don't know what the others are.
So, does everyone have a sense of their task?
Anyways, but.
So the next item is to review and approve the MOU for, yes.
I work better on deadlines and I don't have a sense of when we're supposed to complete our task.
That's somewhat up to the committee.
Yeah.
At this point, this is a version of the plan that applicants are going to be referring to for this coming round.
I wasn't necessarily looking at
the
committee to respond.
Right, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to review it and then have my committee approve it at our September meeting. And so I would suggest that we try to pull it together sometime in October.
Except that we're waiting for Sarah to update with factual stuff. And I would like to wait to review with Joy.
From, let's see, when would everybody like that? I like that.
End of August?
Yeah. It won't take that long.
What deadline would you like?
End of July.
No, for the
mid-August.
August could be a little bit harder. End of July is here.
And that will make you feel like you can do something. So no.
Okay.
So I will have the revised plan out by August 14th.
Again, in terms of procedure, you're supposed to hold a hearing on needs, right? To hear from the community. At the last time around, we did that after the changes in the plan were written. So you could do that. You have a date open in October now, 14th, which was your extra meeting. Dark enough and there's not enough to do outside that they will come and set up to a meeting where the votes can participate.
It hasn't worked well, nothing's worked well for this meeting, but it hasn't worked well just to be like, come tell us what you like.
Yeah, no.
That really hasn't worked.
And the act of going back to each committee for public discussion of those topics wouldn't suffice.
Oh, not in the, well, the statute
not
says
for
you're supposed to hold the hearing.
It doesn't even say how often we're supposed to do
no.
it. We've just done it every time we've updated the plan, just for good public profit.
Well, that's also something for us to look at, is to get out of a two-year cycle into something that makes more sense.
It used to be a one-year cycle. That really didn't make sense.
Right, but then if we're relying on a plan that's 8 years long, why are we trying to force something that's not realistic?
I mean, it's kind of different every time. Sometimes we look at the plan and say, oh, it's good. Sometimes we look at it and say, oh, this is terrible, and it's so outdated, and we need to fix it, but it's different.
The other thing is that when it was started, our procedures were not well developed. And so there were part of a much larger portion of this. There wasn't a lot of discussion of the need sections. A much larger portion of the discussion was, what did we just do during the last round? How is it not accurately representing our plan? How do we change our plan? We had to incorporate things like expedited review. We had to incorporate timing and other things that were not accurate. So that was, those are changes that we're not making as often.
So if we do it in October, when people might be curious about what we're doing anyways, because we're giving out money, then it might be a great time to get the Gazette to draw people interest in that part of it.
Ever since I've been here, we've never had a person come
to the table.
Can we post the draft?
Yeah.
And
then we don't first have one.
You could announce that you will give money by percentage according to the number of you to represent, come representing each area.
If you're doing it at the public comment session, just hold it in. You'll have people here. And of course, they might want to say that their project is absolutely what's necessary.
Be a lot of kids.
I think we're done with playground. At least for this round. I don't think we're going to.
All right, so MOUs?
So because these weren't contracts, I borrowed from previous MOUs, and then at the end just stuck on whatever it was exactly word for word that we had in the council order. So I don't know which one we want to start with. Do we have any preference?
Which one do you have?
Conservation. So this MOU is exactly the same in every way as the MOU for the previous.
Exactly the same as what? I'm sorry.
The MOU from the previous one. All I changed was the dollar. And the date of the council board. So because these are MOUs and not contracts, there's not as much of a hurry for applicants to have something in hand. City agencies can still do their outside contracting without having the MOU signed. So if people want more chances to look at this, yes.
Close the parentheses.
Where?
After dollars.
It's closed after.
Oh, good.
It's closed after dollars.
I'm sorry.
So what I just heard you say is that all we need to check is the dollar amount.
Yeah, or I could, I have, honestly, I haven't been doing it. I might bring it all up, so I just did these today. But if we want to postpone this until the next meeting, that's fine.
If you wanted me to read them, you'd have to do that.
They're not going to be on where you're going to
be. Read one and then check the numbers on all the others. I think that's what.
Yeah, and it's just that and thinking about if there's any conditions that we should have that weren't big enough to be included in the council.
Which leaves us with.
Before we do that, since Downey has been a very long-standing member of the committee and an excellent chair, they're giving you a sign, and it's specific to open space, which is great, and it's signed by everyone in the community.
It's the value
for all of your partners.
$49.99 or less. Otherwise,
yeah, it is very much that number.
Now that we've written on it, it's real hard.
No, so you destroyed public property.
Yeah.
Thank you all. It's been an honor.